there are delivery robots, like this one from Starship. I have never seen one of these before, but I love the idea to have someone to bring me the packages home I ordered online. So I decided,
fine, I'll do it myself.
But I didn't do it just for fun. I built the shuttle as part of my final year project. But what is the idea behind all of this? Well, I wanted to build a device to transport packages or cargo from A to B. The shuttle should be equipped with a variety of different sensors, in a way that self-driving is possible, but let's face it, it is really, really hard to achieve, and if giant companies can't do it, well, neither can I. Also, there is the law which generally makes everything really, really hard. I didn't want to spend more than 700 bucks on it. I didn't waste my time planning much, immediately hopped into Fusion 360 and started modeling a first version.
This is garbage. You actually like this?
Well, well, I came to the realization that doing random isn't the solution to this problem, so I started right from the beginning, but this time by planning and structuring the work.
Several months later.
The new version features a door which can be automatically opened, and the whole thing can be separated into two pieces. In case your cargo is, I don't know, wardrobe or something. Okay, let's get to work. The first thing I built were the wheels. Coincidentally, I stumbled across hoverboards. They might not be the best internet type, but they are really, really useful for this project. Therefore, I bought four of them online for around 20 bucks each, which is just fine, I think. So, with the motors inside the wheels, there is much more free space. Luckily for me, there was a milling machine just sitting in the corner of the workshop, and I used it to remove the pattern from the hoverboard wheels so it wouldn't look all copy-pasted. I had to drill a small hole into the motor for the air valve to fit, because I was using bigger air tires. The battery is the powerhouse of the cell, or in this case, the shuttle. I tried to use lipo-cells for the battery, as they are the most energy-dense type yet. But after checking the price online, I just realized that this was just not going to happen. Luckily, I still had the hoverboards laying around, and guess what? The batteries were made of the exact same battery type I needed, so I took them apart. And after that, I swapped a few broken ones and reassembled them with a spot welder and some nickel strips. Added a BMS, a battery management system, and 3D printed these new boxes to hold them. In the end, I had three batteries. Why not four, you might ask? Well, I didn't have enough batteries nor motivation to do that, and they seemed to work just fine. To store these batteries, I built a compartment which can be pulled out. So if the batteries run out, you can just replace them in a few seconds. First, I built the cover, cut it, drilled some holes in it, and screwed it all together with some 3D printed objects and a lot of plastic. And the stupid plugs just didn't want to fit in. The only thing left to do was to solder the plugs together and mount the cover onto the rest of the build. But there was a new problem now. All the electrical parts need different voltages. The sensors need 5, the motors used for steering need 12, and the motors, like the big ones, 42. To solve this problem, I designed a PCB, slapped some voltage converters on it, and added some extra pieces to be able to determine how long the shuttle is approximately going to run. Before the battery run out. Send it all to China with GLC PCB, they're just the cheapest out there. A few weeks later, the package arrived and I soldered it all together. The battery compartment was finally done. Oh no, wait. No, it isn't. You still can't charge it. Just plug it in, similar to any electric car. That was the idea of my concept. I wanted to use a random plug first, but decided to use this instead. This is probably forbidden and highly dangerous, but who cares, right? There's still the need to convert the AC to DC, and for this job, I used the old hoverboard chargers and screwed them onto a plate. After the batteries, I did the frame. So I packed my hard-earned cash into the bag and drove off to the next hardware store and got myself some aluminium square tubes, as well as some sheets.
I need like a lot of those.
Because I thought aluminium is superior to iron. No rust, shiny all the time, super lightweight, easy to work with, probably stable enough for this job. I was so wrong. I didn't have a welding machine available, but I was lucky. Around that time, a car garage approved my request to weld my project together. But from here, it all just went downhill. You see, I needed to mark and cut those things. And the joke here is, the frame is made out of approximately 130 individual parts. Now hear me out. I never did this before and nobody told me that this was bad. Like, this was a horrible decision. So I packed all of the parts into an IKEA bag and went to the garage only to experience the shock of my life. Turns out, I bought the wrong aluminum. But it's not my fault really. At the store, they sold three types of tubes labeled silver, which is the cheapest one, Nature, the middle one, and anodized. This is the expensive one. I mean, I knew that you can weld anodized materials, but I wish I knew that silver was actually anodized as well. Turns out that I had to polish every single piece before welding it. As you might have guessed, that's an incredible amount of time wasted. If I just spent like 50 bucks more on the material, of the material in nature, life would be so much easier. Anyways, grinding everything away resulted in a significant drop of accuracy and the overall aesthetics. So if you have the chance to use another material, use iron. It's cheaper, more stable, and easier to work with. After welding the upper and lower part together, it was time to hide the frame with some hopefully more aesthetic sheets of metal. I printed the shape onto paper and glued it to the sheet. Afterwards, I cut it out with this thing. Honestly, the worst part was probably the steering system. So many moving parts. See this? Yeah, this is like the fifth version of this thing. So how did I do this? Three steps. Step one, I designed it. It looks nice. Step two, I printed and assembled this thing. Step three, it breaks. I freak out and go back to step one.
How many parts did I have to print till it actually works?
This is probably a normal day in the life of an engineer, but I gotta say, it sucks so bad, really. My mistake was to try and design absolutely everything from scratch, despite not having any engineering knowledge. Anyways, after testing different materials, such as PLA or patchy, I was able to get some decent results. They still all broke eventually, but... All I needed was approximately 1,000 Swiss francs to finish this project on time. So I did some research and wrote 17 emails, or even more, and attached this here. This is a short documentation about my project, why they should sponsor me. I also included these incredibly beautiful renders.
Much, much, much later.
7 wrote back, and out of these 7, 5 rejected me.
Eventually.
2 individuals gave me 500 Swiss francs each, which was perfect, really. With another 1,000 in the bank account, it was time to continue working, now back to the steering system. Parts which could be made with the CNC machine in the workshop were made with it. The steering system was built twice, making both axes steerable. Cheap mountain bike shock absorbers were used, and these giant linear motors were used for the steering. I was slowly running out of time and used absolutely everything that was available on the market. Linear motors, for example, are really slow, but at this time I couldn't find an alternative, and I was like, yeah, this is fine. But after some tests and countless fails, it was ready to be built into the shuttle. So, it was finally time for the final assembly. And you know what? I'm not gonna comment it. Just sit back, drink a Coke, and enjoy it. One thing to mention is, the last few weeks I worked until 2 o'clock in the morning because the assembly wasn't that straightforward. Thank you. clock is ticking, and I'm still missing one crucial part, the motherboard. I fired up EagleCAD's software and threw all the needed components inside, connected them, and sent that thing off to China at 3 a.m. in the morning. I spent like $50 on the 4-day delivery from China. Screw the money, I got 7 days to make that thing drive. It's Monday morning, the package was delivered, and I immediately packed my stuff and took the next train to the workshop and started soldering everything together.
And the shuttle is controlled with this thing here. This is an Arduino Mega.
Eventually, the motherboard, while huge, seemed to work just fine. I screwed it into the frame and started connecting all the cables together. As you can see, I pulled an all-nighter. Let's talk about the programming for a second. So basically, I started with making all objects. After I brought the matura paper to school at 7 o'clock in the morning, I skipped school, just went home and straight to sleep. So, I spent 750 hours working on this project and approximately 1,800 Swiss francs. What grade did I get, you might ask? Well, I did mess up the written part and walked away with a 5, which is acceptable, but
this bad boy here can't drive. I'm sorry, I really am, but after bringing it to my school and Ausstellung, what is it called in English? Yeah, after presenting it in my school for like a month or something, brought it back here and I don't think this is driving anymore. Let's quickly summarize all the things that went wrong while building and designing this thing. So, to summarize, these are a small part of our problems. I couldn't fit all of this in this video because it would be way too long. I spent too much time, cash, and a big part of my sanity into this project. I actually am really happy to have done this. And thank you all for watching, and this is so much time.